God told me to do it. How many times have you heard that in your life? I heard from God. God says, it's something that's quite common in all religions. It's kind of common right across the whole, the whole gamut of humanity. God told me. I want to delve into how to actually hear the voice of the one true God. And we'll see if God tells people things or he doesn't. Hi, folks. Welcome back again this week. Well, this week's video, title says it all, How to Hear the Voice of God. There's some things, there's some criteria that has to be set down to actually understand how to differentiate between one's own thoughts and the actual voice of God. And no, they're not the same thing. There's one of the points is to remember that God is spirit. And this spirit we call God is truth. How do you tell what's true and what's not? Even Pilate said to Christ when he was standing right in front of him, what is truth? Jesus is truth. Father truth in flesh. Father truth is the Greek creator of heaven and earth and all that is in them. That means he created the solar system, the galaxies, the cosmos, planet earth, the sun, the moon, the stars. He created everything. He created mankind. He created the aliens. He created all life everywhere in the entire cosmos. Father truth. And here's Jesus standing in front of Pilate. Pilate saying, what is truth? Had he only known who stood in front of him, eh? So God is spirit, and the spirit we call God is truth. Now you have to ask yourself, what's the spirit of truth? And the spirit of truth is love. Because only love creates and maintains. Hatred only destroys, doesn't maintain, doesn't give life. Only love gives life. And really, in all of creation, all you got is love and hate when it comes to survival. Animals, they live by instinct. They don't reflect truth and love as we know truth and love. They reflect truth and love as to what surrounds them. Their environment dictates. There's no question that a mother moose loves her calf. And a mother wolf protects her cubs. Mother bear protects her cubs. Little hummingbird protects its young ones. So, animals love, but their love is specifically directed as per their environment. So you can't expect to just walk up to a wild moose or a bear or a wolf or even a hummingbird and reach your hand out and say, come here, little guy. Because to him, his environment has taught him that we're to be avoided. But with care and attention, those wild animals can be tamed. So they know love and they know hate. I've seen wolves fighting. I've seen bears fighting. You can go to the zoo and you can watch the great apes or the chimpanzees, and you can see the community and the stresses that some of the occupants of that community will put on the others, and you can see hate. Somebody's going to get a beating. So they understand love and they understand hate, but only per their environment. So the spirit we call God is truth, and the spirit of truth is love. Okay, I guess we can pretty well fix that as a reality. So you think of the soul. We talk to the soul often. The soul is the thoughts of the mind and the desires of the heart. Well, those thoughts and desires change constantly, do they not? And yet there is what they call the man inside, the girl inside. Every one of us, we have a fix on the true individual, the character of a person. Is a person's character reflective of truth? No, but what is truth? But I heard the voice of God. I heard him audibly. Yeah. Perhaps not. If God is spirit, and this spirit we call God is truth, and as the Bible tells us, the devil is falsehood, and his spirit is, especially begins with the hatred of truth, the devil can also love his own. Don't think that he doesn't know what love is about. He does. But he hates truth, and he wants to play God. He wants to push God away, run his own show. So, is falsehood not a spirit? So we have truth and we have falsehood. Black and white. Darkness and light. As light is understanding, and darkness is ignorance, is the devil, does he teach enlightenment to hear the voice of God? No. Thinking again of the soul being the thoughts of the mind and the desires of the heart collectively, you know, the man inside, what is it that creates those thoughts and desires? Is it not our surroundings? Are we not what we eat? The animals certainly are. If the mother moose sees the hunters last fall killing her mate, she's going to avoid the hunters this fall. She's got her young one with her. She's learning from her environment. Yeah. But mankind is different from the animals. Mankind reflects the image and likeness of God. And that too is a cool, quite a study. The image of God, the Bible tells us, is that the ability to use logic to reason and separate or divide truth from falsehood. That's the image of God according to the Bible. And yeah, you'll spend some time studying the Bible to come to that conclusion. If you put the time in, well, no one will ever change your mind. Once you see it, you'll see it. If you don't put the time in, well, you're left looking at Ed and saying, is that true? What is truth? So, as God and the devil are spirit, what spirits call to the hearts of men, to the minds of men? Are we not what we eat? Or will we not become a reflection of our environment? The answer is yes. So the more truths, man is a mechanic. The more he studies mechanics, the better the mechanic will become, as long as his heart is in it. You go to a lot of mechanics and they have no idea how to fix a car today because they haven't stayed up with the progress of technology that is involved in creating today's automobiles. So they're not a very good mechanic because their heart wasn't in it. Like I say, a good mechanic, he keeps studying. He keeps up with the technological changes so that he can repair your car, no matter its age. If you're a person inclined to search for God, you'll find hints of God in all doctrines, everywhere, all around the globe. But the Hebrew Old Testament, it is the finest record available to mankind. It is the finest. And strangely enough, the Bible, the Old Testament, does actually tell us that, you know, the Israelites, the Hebrews, were God's chosen people. He chose to plant his word among them. Doesn't mean they all followed it, obeyed it, or even understood it. But it says that he chose to plant his word among his chosen people, the Hebrews, and that it was their task to take that word and spread it around the world. So I trust myself, I trust the Old Testament. Then we come to the New Testament. Can it be trusted? Well, the Old Testament makes prophecies, and there are a lot of them. Depending on one's maturity, it can be anywhere from 32 direct prophecies concerning the coming of Messiah to 300 to 600, depending on one's maturity. The more you know, the more you study, the more you'll understand. And that's why some people can find that you know, the big glaring ones, 32 prophecies directly connected with the coming of the Messiah, the identity of the Messiah. Other people, maybe they see 300 of them. Other people see 600 plus. So we hear things, we're taught things, and we become what we eat. If a child is born in a whorehouse, a brothel, and raised among prostitutes, that child is liable to embrace the lifestyle of the prostitute. That's what they've learned. They'll know many things concerning everything from contraception to deception. If a child is raised as a Muslim, for example, they use the Quran as their guide, and they will more than likely become Muslims when they grow up. And the directives of that book will form the man inside, the woman inside. It'll form their character. In the same way, a person raised with just the Old Testament, Jewish, the same thing happens to them. Then we turn to the Christian who accepts both the Old Testament and the New Testament. We accept the New Testament because the Old Testament predicts everything that the New Testament records. All that information, even the book of Revelation, comes from the Old Testament. You have a glaring hint right at the very first chapter, the very first verse of Revelation. What did Johnny see? He tells us. I saw the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. Revelation 19:10 says the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. So he saw the prophecies coming to fruition from the Old Testament word in the New Testament word. And this is why the Christian accepts both the Old and the New Testaments. And you are what you eat. So the Christian, in putting things together, if someone asks me, what is truth? My instant reply, I don't care what we're talking about. The question could be so ridiculous. We'd be working on a car, me and my buddy. And can't get it running, can't get it running. My buddy might say, good Lord, what's the truth of this matter? My instant reply is Jesus. Jesus is Father Truth. He'll probably be confused because he'll think, well, we're talking about how to get this car to run that we can't seem to find the problem. And here's old Ed, you know, Jesus is truth. And that, the Bible tells us that the man who has that confession can be trusted much more than the man that doesn't have that confession. I can lose something and I can't find it, and I search and search and search until even the point of where you give up. And then you look down and walk into a room or something, or all of a sudden, there's what you were looking for. There's your lost coin or your lost carburetor part or whatever. My immediate response, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You answered prayer. I was searching for this and I could not find it. You answered prayer. And sometimes it might even be, I go looking for something and boy, I give up. I can't find it. A month later, there it is. And I think, my goodness, it was right in front of me all the time. Why couldn't I remember where I put it? But thank you, Lord. I found it. The truth helped me. There are a lot of things. Pull up my old first book I ever wrote. And it's a big one. And all it is scripture. But it's scripture put into chapters. Thoughts. First chapter of the book. Thoughts. And as you can see, it's page
after page after page after page. Don't get tired. After page after page of scripture.
What it says in the Bible. And that's just concerning thoughts. That's how you learn things. That's what's forming the man inside. I trust the book as being the Word of God. God is truth. His Spirit is love. Jesus is His name. He wrote the book. No prophet spoke of his own imagination, his own conjecture, his own thoughts. He spoke as he was guided by the Spirit. The Spirit is truth. And the Spirit of truth is love. Love drove him to read the scriptures, to listen to what's going on around him, and to hear from God. That's thoughts. The second chapter of this book is concerning spirits. And again, there are page
after page after page after page after page. My goodness. After page. After page. After page. After page.
Just concerning spirits. Everything written on this pages is just quotations from scripture. That's all it is. It's called study. Spirits. Think of the soul. Go back to the soul. The thoughts of the mind, the desires of the heart. Well, the thoughts of the mind are electrical impulses. The desires of the heart are spurred by the thoughts of the mind, which are electrical impulses. So the soul is a collection of electrical impulses. The man inside. Well, Einstein's conservation of energy law, energy cannot be destroyed, it can only change form. Cannot be destroyed. So the soul cannot be destroyed. I don't care if you're a righteous man or a wicked, demon-possessed asshole. I don't care. The soul cannot be destroyed. God judges the soul. Or should I, pardon me, should I not say that our confession and our behavior while we are in these bodies of flesh, the soul, remember, is housed within this body of flesh. The body of flesh gives the soul the ability to operate. I can think about something and I can want something, but if I don't have arms and legs, I can't do that. I can't go and get it, or I can't bring my thoughts and desires to fruition. I can't operate. Without a body, the soul can't operate. It's trapped. It has thought and it has desire, but it has no body. So you need a body to operate, right? Well, can a spirit effect a body? The answer is yes. If the spirit can convince the body that the spirit is true. I heard from God. You best test that before you start saying you heard from God. You best test it. You test the spirits to see if they're from God, Father Truth, reflective of love, or if they're from the devil, falsehood, Satan, reflective of a hatred of truth. They can be reflective of love and still come from Satan. But do they love God? Do they acknowledge the truth? And that's why the words of anyone who confesses that Jesus is Lord can be trusted much more than the words of a person who does not acknowledge and confess that. Those who belong to truth will believe us. Something to consider. The next chapters of this book, I won't aggravate you with me holding up a bunch of pages again. But the next chapter is conscience. And there are quite a few pages of conscience as well. What the Bible has to say about conscience. Conscience, in fact, is the science can't explain conscience. Can't explain it. But the Bible does explain conscience. The conscience is the mechanism through which the spirits speak to us. But what spirits are speaking? We interpret those spirits as conviction. I had to do it. God told me I had to do it. It was just, I could not say no, I had to do it. Be careful. Test those spirits and see whether they're from God or from the devil. You best test them. So how do we test them? Well, in the course, let me see if I can find a page here. Here's some spirits that come directly from the devil. There is no question. Contempt, slander, malice, pride, gossip, envy, quarreling, jealousy, outbursts, anger, factions, disorder, and greed. The Bible specifically identifies every one of these as not coming from God. If they don't come from truth, they have to come from falsehood. That's right. Let's look at some opposites. Opposite of hate. Love. Opposite of depression. Joy. The opposite of dishonesty. Honesty. The opposite of disobedience. Obedience. The opposite of arrogance. Humility. The opposite of being inconsiderate of others. Being considerate. Flippancy. sincerity. Partiality. Impartiality. You catching this, eh? Vindictiveness. Forgiveness. Forgiveness is the opposite of vindictiveness. Vindictiveness does not come from God. It comes from the devil. Test the spirits. Impatience. What is the opposite of impatience? Patience. Which one comes from God? Unfaithful. What's the opposite? Faithful. Out of control. Self-control. Evil. Good. Untruthful. Truthful. These are only a few of the spirits that call unto man. And do you see how both God's spirit and the devil's spirit call to the soul, the minds, the thoughts, and the hearts, the desires of us, all of us, all of humanity? Everyone hears the spirits. But if you fail to test them, you'll be deceived. Once in a while, you'll hit everything right. You'll actually listen to and obey God's voice. More than often, you won't. Because if you listen to these, you want to take the time, write them down. Can you see that? Write them down. And put them together. You'll be stunned. Opposite of flippancy. Sincerity. Partiality. Impartial. Vindictiveness. Forgiving. Impatient. Patient. Unfaithful. Faithful. So you find yourself in the morning getting up, going through your morning ablutions, put the coffee pot on, pour a cup of coffee for your sweetheart. Your sweetheart gets up. Not a good night. Made a coffee for you, honey. I don't want no coffee. Not very loving, is it? Out of control, self-control. She decides she wants something else. She starts rooting around. Get out of my way! Bad night? What do you care? You are aware that demons are false ideas. Now look what's controlling your sweetheart. Because she's completely forgetting sincerity, impartiality, forgiveness, patience, faithfulness, and self-control. She's completely forgetting them. just one example. Oh, or he is completely forgetting them. I don't want to be accused of pointing my fingers at the ladies in the house, because I'm not. It just as often the male who does not know how or refuses to keep his soul in check. Who's directing our lives? We choose. We have that ability. That's the likeness of God. We choose to be like God, who is truth and whose spirit is love, or we choose to be like the devil, who is falsehood and he hates truth. His love is always perverted, always twisted. I love you, honey. Yeah, you say that all the time, but you don't mean it. It's not hard to recognize the devil. It's not hard to recognize demons. They're all around us. They're in us. You see, the excuse is always, well, I didn't get a good night's sleep. I haven't had my morning cup of joe, my caffeine fix to get me started. I'm under stress. It's going to be a really hard day, and I know it. And these are my excuses for behaving like an asshole. The flesh, all the things of the world that people worry about, not guarding their thoughts and their desires. The spirit world is a wide open world. The conscience is a wide open world. If God is truth and his spirit is love, how could we kill animals and eat them? This is an example from scripture that Paul dealt with. How can we kill them and eat them? They have a right to life too. Paul's reply was, Jesus saves those who love him. So don't let your conscience dictate something that goes against what God has done for you. You see, God doesn't see death from the perspective that we see death. He doesn't view things the same way. I will admit, I think that the death of any creature, I don't think it's all that pleasing to God, but I also think that God knows that, well, it's the way I set it up. They die, they come back to me, my realm. I don't like to see anything put to death and made to suffer in doing so. So I'm one of these people that I, for many, many years, more than half of my life, I was an avid hunter. But I was one of these people that if I couldn't get a shot where I could guarantee in my mind and heart that that animal did not suffer, but dropped stone cold dead the instant my bullet hit it, I wouldn't take the shot. I won't see an animal suffer. We've changed our slaughter yards, for example, over the decades to reflect a more humane slaughter. I watched them over in other lands. I'm not going to point my finger at anybody, but I watch people slaughtering sheep and goats and stuff in other lands. And they tie the animal by the legs, and they take and they pull its head back and they slice its throat. Well, it is not that easy to slice through hair and hide to cut the jugular of an animal. And even when you have done that, it takes 6 minutes for it to die. I don't like it because the animal suffers. It's distressed. You don't think the animal feels that knife plunge into its neck, slice across? You don't think it feels it? It feels it. So I am a great proponent of humane slaughter. Nowadays we use a cartridge shell in a gun with a metal plunger. When the shell goes off, it drives the plunger forward. They put it right here on the forehead of the animal, and it goes off and it blows a hole right through the skull and into the brain, and the animal is unconscious. It no longer has functioning thought. The instant the trigger's pulled on that stun gun, then the animal can be hoisted up and its neck slit and the blood drained out, and the animal is not in any distress. Are there slaughter yards who don't do it right? Sure there are, and there always are. But that's how I like to do it. And if an animal is slaughtered properly and humanely, I have no problem eating its flesh to sustain my own life and the life of my daughter. I have no problem with that. So I don't let my conscience condemn me. I don't. Because the conscience is simply that mechanism that through which the spirits communicate with human beings. That's all the conscience is. It's just a mechanism. I do not worship my conscience. So I might have a feeling in my conscience that this, I should do this, or I should do that, or quick, do this, do that. When, don't do it. Not the right way. You're standing beside a fast flowing flood. And someone has fallen in and they're floating by. They're drowning. And someone immediately, their conscience says, help them, you know, jump in. That might not have been the best advice to listen to, but that's what their conscience told them to do. And they end up drowning along with the person who they could have saved if they'd have just taken the time, just an instant, to think, perhaps, of the training they received and how to deal with a situation like that. So you see, the conscience is not necessarily the voice of God. People say, just listen to your heart. I say, the person who listens to their heart without testing the spirits is a fool. You will be dragged in every direction. The devil will mess with you to no end if that is what you think you should do. If you think you're so holy that only love directs your steps, you've really missed the boat. Because love, in the absence of truth, is a lie. Something to consider. So how do you hear the voice of God? Well, you'll hear many voices. Don't worry, you will hear many voices. You will dream many dreams. You'll see many visions. It doesn't mean they're from God. Test them. And if you're wise enough to have taken instruction from the mighty counselor who speaks through his word, he doesn't speak through your conscience, he speaks through his word. I shouldn't say that. He does speak to your conscience, but just listening to your conscience without the instruction of the word, then it's a crapshoot as to whether you're obeying God or listening to God or listening to the devil and obeying him. It's a crapshoot. You are what you eat. The more you eat of truth from God's word, the better equipped you'll be to display the love of God. Love is a good beginning. I won't say it's not. Don't forget the truth. Don't forget the truth. His name is Jesus. His name is Jesus. And he will help you to understand. And he will help you to make the right choices. Some people say, well, I confess that Jesus is Lord. I'm a Christian, but they live like a Christian on Sunday and they live like a demon the other 6 days of the week. Something wrong. No. That's why our day of rest is every day of the rest of our lives. We don't want to play God anymore. We want to follow God. We want to become servants of God. We want to become people who God is pleased to call us his friend. Don't know if I said enough or not. Lord willing, I'll be back again next week. Lord not willing, I won't. If you have any suggestions or questions, please put them in the comments. I love to hear from all of you. I know that each of you is just as capable of speaking the word of God as I am. Don't forget, Jesus is Lord. Love one another. Love y'all. God bless.